Beware your host, Jonathan Holmes.
Hi, everyone. How are you? Thank you for joining me on this fine Sunday in December. And I'm here with Joe Lammert and George Royer. Did I say that properly?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oof, scary. You guys are of White Whale Games out of Austin, Texas?
Yep.
You're Texas? Yes,
we
I don't know if we're she's a
I'm Texan.
I'm an Alabamian living in Texas.
But Austin Austin pretty much is like a town of transplants. So it's actually kind of shocking when there are actually like it's like, oh wait, you're actually from Austin? But like they exist, but no, it's mainly like, oh, people all over the place coming over here.
Yeah, people tell me Austin is kind of the progressive, upbeat, strange part of Texas.
Yes.
Is that right?
No doubt. Definitely true.
Kind of the Seattle of Texas, sort of?
Yeah, you could say
totally.
That.
Seattle, Portland, you know, yeah, it's definitely the blue dot in a sea of red, you could say.
Huh, interesting. And you guys made God of Blades, which is your first game from White Whale Studios. Tell us about how all that happened. You look so young and spry.
Thanks.
You already started making the video games. Yeah, did you go to college for that? How long have you been in development? How long have you been working together? Tell us your whole story.
Thanks.
Well, you want to tell the creation tale?
Oh, man. Okay, well, so essentially, myself and George were not working in video games prior to White Whale Games forming. But, I mean, it started pretty much with myself, George, and then the creative director, Jason Rosenstock. We all were just pretty good friends. And, in fact, we met Jason Rosenstock. You want to tell how we met Jason?
Yeah, we used to go to this sort of coffee place and bar called Spider House because they have a lovely patio with Christmas lights and such for staying up late and hanging out. And we saw a guy doing a digital painting of a Sasquatch, and it was real good. And I was like, what? Walked over to him. I was like, this is a pretty good Bigfoot. And he's like, thanks.
And a friendship was born.
And a friendship was born. And we invited him to come sit at our table, and then he was working at BioWare at the time. He was an environment artist on the Old Republic, the Star Wars thing. And and so when his contract was up there, we just had always talked about doing a game because we all have really complementary skill sets and that kind of stuff. So it just kind of went from there. And then we picked up our programmer and technical guru, and
That's the core team. I mean, essentially White Whale Games formed really at the end of the day because a bunch of friends were hanging out and just wanted to make really pretty things. George and I met in grad school. He's a PhD student in the School of Information at UT, and I got my master's there. And so we had met there. My background before that was doing like film production. And so it's kind of cool. Like all of us kind of have very cool, unique backgrounds that not necessarily just straight up in games, but are all very complementary towards game design.
Yeah, we're sort of an unusual crew. Like I have a background in law, and I also have worked at CNN and the Academy for Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, and I've done a lot of work with film preservation and that kind of stuff. I'm kind of a film nerd to the max.
So why would you guess you ended up going towards game development as opposed to film, if Joe and yourself are both have a film background?
Well, for me, I love games. I've always loved games, and I think that so I like any medium that tells it, that's capable of telling a compelling story, and that was just something I really wanted to do. And I don't know. I didn't want to make a film. I wanted to make a game, and so.
And you did.
It's a good question, and we did.
Totally.
And God of Blades, for those who haven't played it, and you should go buy it, because it's 99 cents. And it feels like, I don't know. It's hard to, things are changing so much in terms of pricing. It's hard to say how much a game is worth these days, because great games come out for $60 and then great games come out for $15. It's very, but this is not a 99 cent game, just production value-wise alone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right now it's on sale for 99 cents. It's normally $2.99 in the App Store, but yeah, it's funny when you're making a game for like a mobile game, just like the intense discussions you have about price point. That's literally between like $1 or $2 or $3. Like it becomes like having hours of conversation over, oh man, well, if we do it this way, are people gonna like us? Or like, you know, we just, it's taken a lot of our time figuring out price point.
Yeah, I bet it has. And you decided, why did you decide on $2.99? When did you look at the other games that were of the same
size? Yeah, we sort of felt any higher would be, would sort of drive people away, because we hadn't put anything else out. And so we sort of thought that was high enough to generate revenue, but not so high to just to, you know, alienate the impulse buyer people.
It's a strange thing. I find that if you price something high, it gives it the illusion of value. Like, I think all of Xbox Live Arcade is kind of based on that. I paid for this, therefore it must be better than PSN because it's free. And your game, it has the illusion of value, and then you buy it, you find out, oh, it wasn't just an illusion. There's like a huge story, and you immediately get to choose between all these different weapons, and there's a simple but elegant combo system. I was knocking guys in the air and smashing them into the other guys, like, right off the bat. It's we should talk a little bit about the game for those who haven't
played. Yeah, absolutely.
Totally.
How did that happen? God of Blades. How did he choose that?
the name or the subject matter? I've always felt like we could have thought of a better name, but it was like,
well, the problem that we run into sometimes is that because it's has the word God, it has the word blades, we get like people are like, oh, what is this? Is this like a God of War thing or an Infinity Blade thing? Like, it's either like one of those directions that people are like, oh, is it one of those? And then it's like, it's not really either of those.
Yeah. So okay, let me see if I can tell the creation tale of this game. Well, when Jason left BioWare, he was doing some art tests and things for sort of proof of concept for a game that we had discussed, which we called the Running Barbarian game. And you know, over the course of a couple days, he did a test run of something with a little character that was just a simple card moving along a path, and we saw that, you know, we actually can make something really cool. And then we designed out the combat system and that kind of stuff, and that ended up changing a lot, because when we brought Adrian on board, Adrian is a very brilliant programmer, and he really likes physics-based things, and he suggested that we make all the combat physically driven, and so that it becomes emergent in a way. You know, the force is simulated, people go flying, all that kind of stuff. Originally, the design was more focused on maintaining momentum and speeding up and slowing down, but then it became more about negotiating this sort of complicated dance. And that's how we sort of thought about it when we were designing the thing. And Jason also has a history as a fight choreographer for stage plays and sword fighting and stuff.
Like I said, we all have done a lot of crazy things.
Shady, shady people.
How old are you? How did you?
I'm 30.
You done?
I'm 32.
Really?
Yeah.
You've already done all the things? Joe, how old are you?
I'm 26, I think. Yes, I'm 26.
We've been doing the things.
That's a lot of stuff you've packed into those years already.
I've been busy.
Yeah.
But, you know. So as far as the other stuff around the game, one of the things that Jason and I bonded over originally was our shared love of classic fantasy stuff and like weird old Pulp Fiction kind of rags and that kind of stuff, and that style of art and that style of storytelling. And then you know, when we were working on God of Blades, we really honed that down towards more of the 60s, 70s feel. And we sort of took the elements of a brawler and a side scroller and sort of wrote them all down and laid them all out and looked at each piece and thought about, well, how can we make this mean something different? And we ended up, by the time we put it back together, there's so many layers of things that are going on in the game. And because it's really a game about memory and a game about, it's a game that's trying to talk to you about the disappearance of things in the world and all things, but it's doing so through the lens of books and forms, a style of illustration and storytelling that's out of vogue or defunct or forgotten, and using that as a way to show that this happens to a lot of other things, particularly analog media in a digital world. And again, this probably has to do with a lot to do with the two things. One is that my mother is a librarian. My first job was at a library. I worked at a library all through high school, and big reader and that kind of stuff. So I've always felt like reading and books are important. And the other one is, you know, I've done work with film preservation and archival stuff. So I like lost things, and I like buried secrets and finding cool, weird things, and just like treasure hunting.
Yeah, that's kind of a shared love at White Whale.
And, you know, Joe came up through the information school with me too, and we talk a lot there about issues of, you know, memory and culture and media and retention and preservation and distribution and all that stuff. So basically, the question was, how do we make a side-scrolling game talk about a complicated issue without shoving it down people's throats, but encouraging them to sort of be thoughtful? But, you know, at the same time, it has to be really fun. So there'll be a lot of people who don't care about that aspect, that find that interesting at all, which is totally fine, because it's a totally awesome sword fighting game too.
Off the bat, when you choose your weapons, one of them has a memory in it.
Yeah, they all have.
My sword is remembering stuff. Yeah.
They all have. All the weapons are memories. They're formed. The ghost of the king, as he grows stronger, he's sort of able to draw on the collective memory of the world that's dying and pull those weapons back into existence. So and use them. So it's not like he's actually, you don't buy anything, you summon it in a way. And so he's, but the weapons themselves are stories, so he's summoning forth stories to oppose the people who are trying to sort of pull everything into the void and erase it all. But it's told in a really it's told in a very fragmented way, because his memory is imperfect and he's a ghost, and ghosts to me are things that are stuck in loops, and a haunting is an endless loop in which I think the individual doing or be whatever being that haunts cannot perceive the walls of its prison in a way, and repeats the same action over and over again. And that is why I didn't, you know, we didn't want to make a thing where you're jumping and doing crazy flips and doing all this kind of stuff, because you are a doomed, tortured spirit that rises up and you cannot stop. That's and so that's sort of from a game mechanic point, it's structurally imposing this sort of curse or damnation on the main character. And he was just like this elemental force this fury that walks the land. And so, but again, you know, I don't want to be like, hey, he's a fury that walks the land, dude. You know, it's like, it's just, it was all designed to be like a thing that you just feel, kind of like, I guess the examples that I use, and let me know if I'm talking too long.
Not at all. Continue.
Some of the examples I use are what I call sort of the iceberg effect, which is where, you know, you only see the 10% you see is buoyed by the 90% that's there that you don't see that's beneath the surface. And like two examples that I like to use are the work of Hayao Miyazaki, where you really feel like it's a really believable, detailed world, and the characters fit and they make sense in their world, but he has a very specific story to tell in that world, and he doesn't, you know, jerk the camera all over the place to just show off cool things, but instead follows the characters in their tale, even though he has this super rich setting and you know there's so much more. It ends up making you feel like if the camera did turn that way, you'd see something else, or that the people are really inhabiting their environments. That was really important. And the other one is, you know, the film Casablanca, which I think has one of the most amazing senses of place, and the way that the character, the city itself and the relationships become a character. And even though it was filmed, you know, on a studio lot, I think, you really feel like if you went and looked around one of those buildings that you'd see the rest of the city and that kind of stuff. So,
Yeah, giving us a thin slice of a greater thing, but making that slice contain all of the information that people's subconscious needs to kind of expand on it.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I totally say too, you know, when we started God of Blades, like George created this giant, essentially like a Bible of the God of Blades universe. Like essentially when you're going through the game, if you point at any artifact that's in the background, any sculpture, or there is a story behind it. Like there's definitely a story, which I'm sure George could talk for like 3 hours.
I think Jason remarked to me that, you know, there's over 1,000 pieces of individual art and things like, or somewhere in the number of that, because his process for crafting those things is pretty interesting. A lot of the, you know, it's on parallax and cards, but each of those cards is unique. He uses unique assets, they don't really repeat, and he hand sculpted all that stuff in ZBrush, and then has a process that he goes through where he paints on it in Photoshop and bakes all the light in and then assembles the landscapes. But, you know, it would take him a long time to put all that stuff together, and it was really hard work, but every place had to be special and unique. Mm. So there's no, you know, brick wall that's just tiling behind you as you run forever or some shit. Oh, it's like,
that much is as clear as soon as you boot up the game. It's like, this game cost how much? Because it just doesn't look like a, $2.99 game. It looks like a $40 3DS game.
Thanks.
Very kind. I think a lot of that reasoning for that goes, or the reason for that goes to, you know, Jason's art direction and strong sense of aesthetics, and it really solid commitment to a level of polish that he felt like the world deserved or needed in order to be experienced in the way that he wanted people to receive it. And I think they've responded really strongly to it. Some people have said some very nice things to us. Some people don't care for the game so much, but nobody's ever said your world looks like shit. It looks, you know, people love it. So
yeah, it's interesting because on the surface, I find that people are more and more dividing games into like, this was supposed to sell to a lot of people and make a lot of money and maybe isn't a very passion-packed project, and people are then looking at other games as well. They didn't expect it to make a lot of money, but they put their heart and soul in it. And God of Blades feels like an amalgamation of that. It's like it's irony free, which for one is weird on the iPhone. So many small,
that's sincere in every way possible.
Yeah, no, we decided early on that you know, we're not going to make games that are ironic. I think you know, I don't know. Irony is a powerful device, but the only way that this was going to work is if we communicated our sincere love for this kind of thing, because you can't really mourn, you know, loss of culture and these kinds of things if you're doing it, you know, and acting like it's funny that isn't this what we liked back then kind of stuff, you know. It had to be totally sincere, and it is, so.
Which harkens back to the sincerity of, you know, Frank Frazetta painting.
Yeah. Right, absolutely.
If you had been jokey about it, it would have been part of what's killing that whole sincere look at
exactly. There's a real sense that that stuff means something to a lot of people, but it's also let's see, how should I say this? It's something that's quirky and eccentric enough that it invites parody very easily, and that's sort of one of the things that I like about it too. But yeah, for our purposes, we were just totally serious.
Yeah,
Very serious about my pulp fantasy love.
Well, and that's the thing too. When we were in early production, you know, we already kind of were trying to essentially, I guess you could say, even like brand ourselves as a company, and you know, just our scrappy four-person team that's working out of people's homes, and then all that fun stuff. But to do some of that, like to really kind of get an idea of like maybe like what our like to understand our audience better. I went to a lot of, like, just talked to people all the time about what we were working on, our project, and quickly realized that the angle that really resonated with people was just talking about, you know, 60s, 70s pulp fantasy paperbacks, which was kind of surprising, but actually not really that surprising, but, like, immediately, like, I would just see, like, I'd be talking about, you know, oh, or, you know, we just started a video game studio, we're working on this game, and there's swords and stuff, and then I'd talk, you know, kind of like, it's like kind of a throwback to those pulp fantasy books, and like their eyes would light up, and they'd start just telling me about like their collections, or like that they're like, oh, at my parents' house, you know, I have a whole box of, you know, like Michael Moorcock books, and, you know, just would just go on about stuff. So we knew that there was something that would resonate with people there with that.
Now, but do you think the audience who appreciates kind of that older cultural stuff is on the iPhone, because you know, it's some, very hard in general.
No problem. Some of them totally do, and you know, we have a lively thread on Touch Arcade forums where people actually started digging up old book covers and stuff online and being like, "Hey, look at this. Oh, and I just read this." And we have a secret sword in the game that you have to figure out a really hard riddle to get, although they talk that, and then the community worked together to figure it out. But in so doing, they were led to discover these certain authors, and a lot of people wrote that they really enjoyed finding these things, and that they finally got sort of what the game was really about, which is about taking you on this journey into this stuff.
Yeah,
I think you want to go.
It's interesting, yeah, because I think there's a lot of people who, you know, immediately identify with the kind of that the pulp fantasy part. But I mean, a lot of people are just intrigued by it, and I think it absolutely, like, it's led a lot of people to discover like fantastic books and beautiful art and stuff like that, which is kind of, I mean, that's exciting to hear.
So it's not always people who already have a pre. They're playing the game first and then finding out about the influences afterwards.
Yeah.
What genre would you put the game in? It's auto runner, I guess.
Yeah.
But it's an adventure. Definitely.
I think that I don't know. I call it a Cosmic Sword Odyssey.
Which isn't an option in the Apple store as you're filling out the form.
I'm sure they just accidentally left that off the list. But no, I think it's an action adventure game with light role-playing elements in it. I guess it is structurally fair to call it an auto-runner. One of our, you know, Cannonball was a big influence, and Adam Saltzman is a real nice guy and a friend of ours. He lives here in Austin too. And I don't know. I think just trying to tell a compelling story in that, you know, with those design constraints was something that was cool to do. Mm-hmm. But as far as, yeah, I guess you could say it's a runner.
Well, it's I feel
a lot
like
of running.
Sure. Well, you slow down sometimes when you parry, yeah. or mm-hmm. but and it's also really fun to get the momentum going. That design, yeah. aspect, I still felt that, even though that was maybe not as focused on as you had initially intended. But the auto runner thing, I feel like there's a stigma, and I hate the stigma of auto runner. People think auto runner, mm-hmm. they just wanted to make a simple game that they didn't really put their heart into. But that's not the case, yeah. at all. You can do so much with it, like Cannonball. Which you mentioned, yeah. that's a game all about desperation, fear, and excitement. And yep. then Bit Trip Runner, I don't know if you played that. That's a game about, like, it's pretty good.
Yeah,
it's all about it's enthusiasm and, like, lust for life and feel like you can never fail. It's like the opposite of Cannonball. Then cool. your game takes Auto Runner and makes it, like, a curse, like you're saying, like, a trap in that.
Well, you're a ghost, so it's not much gonna not gonna get that much better for you, you know? You're already dead.
Sure. Do you believe in ghosts for real? I don't want to forget that.
I don't know. I don't really have much of an opinion about that, you know.
I'd like to believe in ghosts.
Me too. If ghosts.
I hope that I never see any and that they don't scare me. That's what I think about ghosts. They stay away me alone.
For me, it would be a relief, because I'm not sure about afterlife. So if I saw a ghost, I'm like, phew, and you can kill me if you want,
there,
then I'll
just
be a ghost.
You will also be a ghost. But
yeah,
hopefully,
it's just like joining the club. Not that scary.
Ghost just club. Like in that movie, Ghost.
Yeah, exactly. Trying to prevent her from getting killed, but he should have just been like, kill her. So
just fucking hang out on the subway with that weird dude that teaches you to flick cigarette butts and stuff. It's going to be great.
I love that guy. That, like, 1950s guy.
Cool. Yeah. And they had that really nasty hair, and I feel like I've seen him in all kinds of stuff, and I just don't know who he is. He's one of those guys that, like, I know that guy. But he was he did a great job as an angry ghost. That's what I'd say about ghosts. More. That and that the end of that movie was really upsetting for me as a kid, with the demons come out and take the dude, you know, like the shadow people.
Oh, yeah.
That was terrifying. Watcher in the Woods was another unreasonably freaky movie that was presented for children. And if you've seen
that movie's terrifying.
Extended cut or whatever, I don't know, this weird, like, crystalline alien thing that comes out at the end, and it's like totally... I know.
Isn't Watcher in the Woods, isn't that produced by Disney?
Yeah, it's a Disney movie.
It's crazy.
It's it's great. And then, you know, something like that would fit well within God of Blades world, like a crystalline entity that's, you know, shooting light and emerging from another dimension. Would be great. I wish I had thought of this. I wish we had this conversation a few months ago.
But God of Blades isn't, it's complete for the iOS, but it's not over. It sounds like you're still working on new versions of it.
Oh, yeah, I remember now, before I started talking about Patrick Swayze, I was going to answer your question, and I think the answer is the design really shines, and what we did or tried to do with the runner thing is that you get into, especially in Endless Mode and our new mode, Revenant, which added asynchronous multiplayer, which is cool. Oh.
It literally happened 2 weeks ago? Yeah, that was 2 weeks ago, our update. Oh, there's an update.
And you can create your own ghosts, and you can sort of send them into other people's realms. And if you have a score of 200 and you challenge me through Game Center, then when I'm playing alone, you will appear in my game if I hit 200 points. And the score will freeze, and then there's like this weird misty sparkly magic stuff, and then the character that you created and customized will come out wielding the sword that you used to get that score. And if I want to beat you, I have to actually beat your guy who you level up and stuff.
It gets crazy. It's pretty much it's swords with friends, essentially.
Swords with friends.
Is what we kind of were calling it as we were putting it together. But dang, yeah, it gets like when we were building Revenant, like, you know, we were all playtesting it, and I'm not gonna lie, it gets mega addictive trying to outplay your friends.
It goes really crazy back and forth. But the thing I keep trying to say and keep distracting my own self is that in the Eternal mode or Revenant, you build up a combo multiplier every time you defeat an enemy without being hit, and that's how you get the really big scores. And you can get up to 25x combo, and you get into this sort of zen. No, I'm not gonna say zen. I hate when people say zen. This is very zen, and I'm like, do you know what that means? Do I know what that means? Mm-hmm. I don't. But you get into a very calm, focused state, a zone, if you will, where you're really vibing with the rhythm and just taking dudes out, and you are not being knocked back or slowed down. And it's this sense of like progression, and it has continuity in that you knock people into the oncoming guys. But it's really a series of duels, And then it can be tough to get back on that rhythm if you get knocked out of it. And all the powers and the weapons are designed to augment that rhythm and give you different choices about how to, you know, handle things. Like, we have one weapon, Barbarox, has an instant interrupt that will stop an enemy's attack. And you can do it any time. Others, you know, have these cool little soul-eating worms that come out of the ground and eat someone's soul and then fly back into the sword that sort of houses them. And then another one is a big crystalline sword that glows and shimmers, and it's actually the sword itself is the first sword to appear in the world, and it's actually lined with a star's dream is inside the crystals, and when you activate it, it burns the sword itself, becomes the surface of the star that it was, and it vaporizes flesh if it touches anyone. But it has to get through armor in some enemies. So I don't know.
Now, are you sad that the word epic has now been like worn out and destroyed?
Definitely.
Genuine use. Because you made a huge epic that now, if I call it an epic, people are going to think, oh, he's trying to sound like he's cool on the internet. But this is the definition of epic.
It's a saga.
Yeah, absolutely.
For sure. And, you know, one thing I'm really proud of that we did is Jason did a great job of bringing to life the ambient creatures that live in the world too.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't fight them. That's just,
they're just hanging out.
That's where they live. And so, there's, you know, winged creatures in the skies and these big things we call ice crushers that lumber through the glacial wastes, and you see herds of them, and it's not consequential mechanically to the player, but it's very important that they see that this is a world that has life on it.
Mm-hmm.
There are things going on, but it's a world that's dying, and there are things that are beautiful and alien and interesting, and you're trying to protect them. And so, kind of like in the... Oh, sorry.
I'm sorry, go ahead. No, you...
Oh, no, I forgot what I was going to say. It wasn't important. I do this all the time. I do this all the time. So.
That's okay. It's all very good content. I appreciate it. It did give me a little bit of the same way Super Metroid made me feel like I was in a place and gave me so much to chew on that I didn't really have to interact with in any way. But I'm not with a Super Metroid feel at all, with very much heavy metal comics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's my frame of reference anyway.
Yeah, I know. I mean, a lot of... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, totally.
And, you know, artists like Mobius was really influential, and so was Roger Dean and his sort of weird, twisted, airy landscapes and all that kind of stuff.
But what? How did you, with $4,000, a Kickstarter? $4,000, you made this thing? How did
God of Blades didn't cost $4,000 at the end of the day. But so when we first started up, like, I mean, essentially our whole project was pretty much bootstrapped. You know, we pretty much all put our money into it, and to fund it. Also, you know, got a little help from George's parents also gave us a loan, which was very, very nice. And from there, essentially, the Kickstarter was going towards the last pinch of software that we needed, like the last set of licenses.
But it didn't cost that much.
It didn't cost that much, though. We always, like, I think the thing is, like, one thing that's really, that makes me really proud is that, like, I kind of always like to say that essentially we made a universe for the cost of, like, a mid-size car, which is... which is cool. Like, I mean, universe versus car, I'll take the universe, so that's cool.
I think we probably spent probably around 20...
Yeah, it was right around
24,000 to pay for help. And, well, we didn't have any software.
Yeah, we had nothing. So starting up, like, especially when you're trying to get something in the App Store and stuff and having to, like, pay for licenses and stuff, it's a pretty penny.
But we, you know, people have... really sacrificed a lot to make this happen. And
we originally didn't even plan to do a Kickstarter, and it just kind of happened where we, you know, kind of were running low on funds. And I think for a while we kind of just were like, oh, we don't really want to do a Kickstarter because we just, you know, we just want to make this game. But then we kind of, we're so close to the finish line and, you know, needed just to fund a lot of, like, that last trail of software. And we were just kind of like, well, why not try a Kickstarter? Which in the end, I mean, I'm so, even though, like, talking about it now, like, we had the scrappiest Kickstarter on the planet, and please no one watch, like, our Kickstarter video or look at any of that, because that is just, like, nightmares for me. No, it was...
Really? I thought it was really endearing.
Thanks.
I liked it a lot.
Well, thanks.
Mostly what Jason and I heard was, you guys need to get haircuts from our friends, because we had, like, like, living like crazy people and making videos and not paying attention to our hair.
Good to hear. At least that, I mean, I think the scrappiness and but the passion kind of resonates in that video. But we were trying to get I don't even remember what our goal was. 3,500. We came out with like 4,000. But which at the time, which sounds hilarious now. Like, that sounds like such a pithy Kickstarter. Like, that doesn't even make any sense. But, like, literally a year ago, around this time when we were literally doing the Kickstarter a year ago, people were like, whoa, you're getting money from people you don't know. And it's like, you don't know them, and they're just trusting you with that. And, like, blew our minds that
we... Yeah, like, some guy in Romania gave you $10? Why?
Yeah.
Why would he do that? And it's like, I don't know.
Yeah.
He thought it was cool.
But it was, what was great for us, too, like, doing Kickstarter, is... I mean, it was interesting because we did our Kickstarter pretty much, like, with a really, really established, like, what we're working on, what we're doing. It wasn't kind of like this, like... early development thing where it's like, here's our ideas, you know, they could kind of change, but like, we were really straightforward with what we were making. And so I think that worked in our favor. We never ever got any challenges in terms of like where the project was headed. We also, you know, we met all our goals that we said we were going to do, like all, you know, our release date and everything. And what was great for us too is that I really feel like through Kickstarter we built a great fan base. Like, being able to talk about this project back then, like a year ago, and just really seeing people want to support it, and seeing just kind of like our passion kind of resonate with other people, that was, I mean, exciting to say the least. But I mean, it really, to me, Kickstarter was just like a way to kind of really grow our fan base and also get a little bit of money to finally get some software to pay for.
And we made some friends out of it too.
Yeah, you know, we definitely did.
Met people that were cool, and I think it would be unfair if I didn't mention the Austin community and the role that all played in development too, because there's a really good sense of camaraderie with the indies here, and you know, people were so willing and eager to help us, like, look at our stuff and give us feedback and help us when we needed certain types of work done, like help us with sound, because that was something that we didn't really have the ability to do ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
We tried. And
yeah.
It was not good.
It wasn't the best. We're really fortunate to live in Austin. I'm not sure if a lot of people realize this, but Austin honestly is like a fantastic city to be an indie game developer. There's a lot of wonderful people here. I mean, just like we were saying, like Adam Saltzman Cannibal, he's here amongst many others. But it's a really fantastic supportive community. And it's through that community that we were able to get a lot of help. Like, just like George was saying, like sound design, like,
yeah. And just moral support too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, ended up becoming close friends with a lot of people. And,
there's a fantastic indie collective here in Austin called Wagos Rancheros, which was founded by Brandon Boyer, Wiley Wiggins, and Adam Saltzman. And essentially, it's just like a once-a-month meetup where people just show off really cool, pretty projects and, you know, and drink and hang out.
Very
and
informal.
It's very informal, but it's a very, very powerful place, I'd say. I really think I have to credit a lot of the success of God of Blades to just, like, the moral support of people over there and a lot of the advice, like, you know, as we were like playtesting and whatnot.
Put you in the frame a little more.
Oh yeah, there she is. Yeah. We've got questions.
I have a whole face.
Oh boy. Yeah, I know, you know, a terrible secret. She's born with half a head. That's why she's always, you know. I'm sorry.
Sermon asks. Oh no, it's rigged. Most iOS games get rip-offs very fast. Uh-huh. Has anyone ripped off your game in hopes that they can cash in on your work as of yet? There's no Blade of Gods out?
No, I was so waiting for Lord of the Sword. Like, that was...
Sword Lord.
Sword Lords. I was so expecting that, but...
She also keeps trying to make this joke called Gods of Blades, where she hopes someone will put Ryan Gosling in the role. And
no, like, it just seems like a great... Happen. No, I'm, I just... You know, I was thinking about that one day. It just seems like something, if a fan wanted really to make Gauze and Blades, you know, they could do it.
You heard,
I wouldn't object.
From her, internet.
Well, you never know. With that,
we'll star in the film adaptation.
He could be playing it right now, for all you know. That's a weird thing.
I know, isn't that trippy? We were talking about that a couple weeks ago. We were like, do you think like any like D-list celebrities have played her?
I just said celebrities. Oh. You're the one that likes the D-list ones. But anyways, no, I don't think it would be very easy to rip it off, because I think so much of what makes it really interesting and appealing is its heart and all the care that went into it. I think it would be a lot of work to just sort of clone it. And I think that would be sort of missing the point too. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Yeah, we weren't really too worried about that.
People do often. I mean, a lot of the clones miss the point of the original. Mm-hmm. It's certainly possible. I think as you get more popular, you may see just like a stick figure version of your game out there. Mm-hmm. With a watered-down version of the combo system. But without the level of skill behind it, you're right, it wouldn't pay off. And how much do you think... how different would the game have been if you didn't have the people with the particular skill sets that you did? Because
it would have been a totally different project. I mean, the thing is, like, we're definitely an unorthodox team, for sure. I mean... Like a lot of small indie developers, but like I always really just like to really express that like all of our skills are ridiculously complementary, and we all bring a lot of interesting backgrounds to the table. And like, you know, we all have different experiences, and you know, through that, you know, I just can't help but think the project would have been totally different if we were all just, you know, all from the same, just, you know, we're all working in the same experiences and then ending up in the same place and working on this project. So
I think it would have been an entirely different beast if even any single member was not there.
Well, like, I think that, like, one thing, for example, one thing I would say too, the lore seeker feature in our game, which for people who haven't, do you want to explain it, since you essentially designed it?
Well, we all did, but the idea was to, we didn't feel so good about doing in-app purchases, so We just didn't want to do it, and I hope we'll never have to. So what we did instead was figure out a system by which people would get rewarded for going to real-world libraries and going where the stories live and sort of going on their adventure, and it bounces Foursquare's API and just checks if you're in a library or not. Mm-hmm. If you are, then you get one of three swords that originally you could only unlock that way, but we decided that we would start rotating content out of Lore Seeker, because not all of our international fans and stuff can get it.
But I was touching on Lore Seeker too, just to kind of, I think that's a good example of like all our different backgrounds kind of creating that feature. Like, for example, I know a huge part of that, like George was saying, his mother's a librarian and he grew up in libraries. Like, you know, we were in information school, which, you know, I worked in libraries while I was in grad school. And like, I think at the end of the day, like libraries are very significant to all of us in a way, in terms of like how this game got built. Like stories really influenced us and libraries are very important to us. So, I'd say that was very heavily influenced by our backgrounds and from our experiences. So yeah,
we also just thought it was cool.
Yeah.
We thought that was cooler than being like, hey, for 99 cents, we give you this blue sword. Wouldn't that be fun? You'll like it.
Yeah, to me, not only is it not cool, but it takes me out of the game. It reminds me that I am a purchaser of a sword and not
and then it becomes kind of gross. World.
Yeah.
You know, I'll never know, but in my mind, I have this fantasy where somebody discovers the library that they didn't even know was in their neighborhood, and then they go in there and they just stop in and accidentally find what ends up becoming one of their favorite books, and that becomes sort of part of the play experience of God of Blades. I mean, in my pie in the sky vision, it does. So yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's very much, that's forcing people to live what the game is a metaphor of, which is,
Right now, there's a really cool level with dragons that's locked with Lore Seeker. It's one of the eternal survival stages, but these really neat, giant red dragons that have four eyes and stuff, and they wink at you as you run by them. It's pretty cool.
Whoa!
You don't fight them or anything because they're just hanging out.
Just hanging out, like
that's just
dragons
where they
do.
Live.
How did it feel to design so much stuff that people may never discover or may never understand? Because on one end, it's packed with content. A lot of it's buried, and a lot of it's also sort of high concept, metaphorical stuff that people might not get.
That's okay, I guess, because we didn't want to do it. It's not about being self-indulgent, you know? Mm-hmm. It's just, it was important to us to put those things there. Mm-hmm. But it's fine if people enjoy it any way they want to. I hate it when people are like, well, you just didn't get my thing. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, it means whatever it means to you. So I hope you like it. And we have had people tell us that the game actually meant a lot to them. We've had one person told us that it caused them to really reflect on the time that they had with their father growing up and reading his paperback book collection and talking about that stuff with him and how that shaped his tastes in music and books and that kind of stuff. But it also, playing the game and thinking about those things helped him sort of think about his time with his dad in a certain kind of way, and that it sort of really got under his skin in a way that most things don't. And it was really, really moving.
I would say the best message games are like that. They don't hit you on the head with it. They give you an experience that you believe you're doing for yourself, and you are, but behind the scenes stuff is leaking into your brain that's leading it.
Absolutely.
Kind of pointed directions.
I would say it's more of a meditation on these things than it is a persuasion. We're not trying to persuade anyone to believe a certain thing or that kind of stuff. It's more just a look around you, encouraging you to look around you, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But we did find posts that were funny. There was one on like BoardGameGeek.com or something. A guy was like, "I've rerouted my, you know, drive home from work. I've discovered 3 libraries on the way. I'm gonna hit them all." And I was like, "Oh, it is a 12-hour cooldown on that, but I'm so happy that you now know where these things are, and maybe you look at the world around you a little bit differently."
Yeah, that's incredible. I'm being a jerk and ignoring the questions.
Oh yeah, oh, I'm yeah. Sorry.
Sorry about that.
Oh, you guys are doing a wonderful job. I'm the slacker here. Slow Holmes asks, "If you are the monarch of armaments, you claim to be. What's your favorite sword and why? Flamberge? Claymore?"
Well, oh wait, you mean in
real swords?
Not in the game. I really like big two-handed swords. I think are the coolest. I remember going to Scotland with my family one time, and we went to the William Wallace Memorial, and they had allegedly like his claymore, and that thing was like 6 feet tall, and I was like, Jesus. So that's my favorite sword. It was huge.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's incredible.
Yeah, and I'm sure Joe probably has.
Oh man, sword. Do I have a favorite sword? That's I'm gonna now.
What's your think about your favorite sword too? While she thinks about hers, and then we can tell each other at the same time.
See, I'm a little different than George though too, because I prefer in terms of like swords when I'm playing God of Blades or any other sword game. I'm much more air for the lighter blade instead of the heavier blade. I definitely would err on that side, but I'm trying to think of a real life sword. I'm gonna think on this, but in the next couple of minutes, obviously
I'm biased towards katanas. I grew up on Usagi Yojimbo comics. I don't know if you read those. What? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I have. What's the guy that does that? Stan
Saki, I believe.
Yeah, yeah, he's great.
He's got a new comic out. It's called 47 Ronin, I think.
Oh, I saw an ad for that.
Yeah, it's touching. It's really nice.
Is it good?
Yeah.
I like
comics.
He's
another guy who gives you that sense of place. Mm-hmm. You know, to put in a lot of little details to just make you feel like you're there.
And if you want my recommendation for my favorite comic of the year is the new run of Swamp Thing.
Oh yeah, that's fantastic. It is. That has nothing to do with swords, but it's great.
No, it does. Well, he can make gross sword arms and stuff, but. Jeez, it's good storytelling. Real good. Really good stuff.
I bought the Swamp Thing annual for the new series.
Yeah.
Just because Becky Cloonan drew it.
Yeah. She is a badass. She's so good. Yeah. Have you seen, she illustrated an edition of Dracula. It's not a comic book. It's just she did illustrations for it. But they're very unorthodox and man, it's great. Should check that shit out.
I will, absolutely. So I like katakanas. Yeah, I mean katanas. Joe, did you have an answer for your sword question? I don't want to pressure you, Joe. I'm sorry.
I feel like all the blades of the world, but that's...
the blades of the world.
My sister actually just sent me a G-chat thing as we're talking, saying Ryan Gosling uses a lightweight sword too. So I don't know.
On whom? He uses a hammer and drive. Maybe a hammer.
Maybe he uses a katana.
Oh, he might.
Yeah.
In his day-to-day life.
Yeah.
You never know. They're fun. Grimslayer asks, "Have you been thinking of sequels to this game? Maybe a more world-based exploration?"
There's been talks before.
Yeah, we've talked about doing another God Blades thing. I don't know that we'll do that next.
No, we're definitely not doing it next. We're not.
I think kind of want to poke around other directions a little bit.
Do you have an idea of what you might do next?
We're just kind of messing around.
Yeah, we have, you know, it's funny because in 2013 we're really like, we have a lot of ideas that are kind of in early development where I think right now we're kind of trying to zero in on how exactly like what our timeline is for like the different projects and how, you know, what we want to maybe like take on first. Because admittedly, God of Blades, if anything, like going through, like we're so proud of it, but also like it was a very massive first project, like for, you know, a small team. Like we kind of realized, it did kind of, expand over the course of, I guess, early production and was like, oh, this is a much bigger thing than
but
we
it
anticipated.
Was, and it was big from the beginning. But the idea was that, you know, it's a crowded market space. It's really hard. We've never done game stuff before. No one knows who we are. So if we want to make an impact and want people to pay attention to us, then we're going to, we can't just make something good. Like, we have to do our best to make something extraordinary. That's sort of what we...
But we also, another thing I'd throw out too that we are, I think we want to focus on a little bit more next year too, is we actually have a sub part of our company that we call Orca, which is essentially this experimental, just us kind of just messing around making, I hate using the word experimental.
Yeah. Oh, I like to think of it as like a weird research wing.
There you go. That's a better way to
like
to
we have
frame
one,
it.
We have one Orca game that you can play. We made it in 3 days. It's called Psychic Frog. You play a frog that's being experimented on by a 70s sort of Bond-esque super criminal organization. And the frog keeps getting out of his cage, and he can form a telekinetic shield around him. And it's you just control him as he runs down hallways that are 3D, and but he's on only on one plane, and he forms his telekinetic shield and picks up objects, so it's physics based. Like, he catches any bullets that are shot at him, and then when you release the field, they all target people in the room, and then if he gets shot, he goes back to sleep and they put him back in his cage, and then he just keeps doing it.
But yeah, that's available to play on our website.
Free.
We'd like to do more smaller projects like that too, so just to have cool weird things.
We could tell people about Slayers too.
Yeah, that's another
we did a multiplayer version of God of Blades and set it, couched it as the prequel, where each side, each player has a roster of 25 foot soldiers, and they're on a bridge and they're sort of colliding with each other, and then they also have a champion who come in light, medium, heavy classes, and they are the bad, they're the antagonists in the main game, and they're sort of doing these ritual battles on this bridge to see who's strong enough to lead, like, war hordes and that kind of stuff. And it's free. It's really fun. You can download it at Venus Patrol teamed up with us to help.
Yeah, Venus, it's actually, yeah, specifically for that, it's venuspatrol.com/slayers. But we made that game originally, or that mode of God of Blades, if you will. We made that originally just for... specifically for Juegos Rancheros, the game collective I was talking about. And then it also, we've had a lot of tournaments since then at a lot of gaming events.
Yeah.
And people really, really enjoy playing.
Yeah, we usually project it onto like a giant screen.
Yeah.
It also sort of shows what we're having a PC and Mac build coming. And, you know, the graphics have been ratcheted up significantly. The environments look even better. And so it's sort of a tech demo in some ways too, but it's also a really fun multiplayer game.
What do you make of the local multiplayer scene? Just everyone
yeah.
I talk to is talking about how it seems to be exploding over the past 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, I actually really like it.
I do too.
Because I see games and play as powerful tools for community building and friendships and
which is what,
like that.
Yeah.
They do have a ability to bring people together, and that's obviously not feasible everywhere. Or for everyone, because not everyone can get up and go to places and such. But, you know, I do think it's really cool. Like, I love playing with the person present. Much more than I do just playing with people online.
Well, it's exciting to me too. I'd say just like seeing a local multiplayer, like at various events and stuff too, is that I feel like it creates access for more people also who maybe don't label themselves as a gamer, or maybe don't feel like that's in the, like, for example, like, I know you I think last week you guys were talking about Joust. Right,
oh,
and which we love, and we play, like, you know, a bunch of events around here. And literally, actually, yesterday, Austin Film Society had an event with Juegos Rancheros was present, and we were there for 5 hours playing Joust. That was like our job there, and it was awesome to just see all the, like, actually for the first time, like, you know, I just got to see so many cool, like, just so many different ages playing. Saw tiny kids, saw senior citizens. There were multiple rounds that were just, like, all women, just, you know, 30, 40-something women just jousting it up.
And, awesome.
I mean, that's just such a fantastic experience.
We taught a we co-taught a game camp for middle school kids at the University of Texas here this past summer, and we were able to bring Joust in, and the kids, they loved it.
They had
so much fun. They begged not to have Joust taken away, but I was like, I'm sorry.
Well, it's just like experiences like that, and then also, like, I'd say, like, Slayers too, just kind of watching people just first interact with it, like, just seeing what sort of strategies people develop, and, like, what's it, like, with Joust, it kills me watching, like, you know, like, there are so many people that came up to me at first being like, well, what is this, and then I was like, oh, it's Joust, you want to play, and they're like, well, what's the rules, it's like, just get in, you'll figure it out, and sure enough, like, then you'll be fine, yeah. And then sure enough, like, you know, very quickly people catch on what's going down, and, you know, whether their strategy is, leaping or pushing people or hiding their move control or whatever. Like, it's amazing, like, what develops from that. And
it's still the best Joust strategy I've ever seen. One of the kids did in the camp, and it was just so utterly baffling to all the other participants that he kind of won because of it. And he just laid down on his controller, face down on the floor, and showed no interest in anything going on. And it was like, what are you going to do? Jocelyn? I mean, he was just, he was ironclad.
Man, it's like the Norway of Johann Sebastian Joust.
Yeah, exactly.
That's impressive.
So,
we just had the video game awards on Friday, and there was a best indie category. Who would have won? Do you guys have a top five of your best games? Did it line up with what the VGA is?
You know, Journey is amazing.
Yeah, it was a Journey that won. Remind me, I didn't.
Journey's great.
It's fantastic.
Journey, Fez, Mark of the Ninja, Dust, and
Dust is the only one of those I haven't gotten a chance to play. So I can't speak to it, but I've seen it, and it's beautiful. I don't know. I mean, that's a strong list, you know. I would have liked to have seen Joust on there, too, maybe, but I don't even know.
But I guess since it's not commercially available right now,
I don't know. I don't know what they're... But I thought it was, speaking of that, I thought it was a little weird that Journey was up there because I thought
because
that
it is published by Sony?
I don't know,
the definition of what indie is sometimes,
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. But I know they deserve an award for something, so, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. I would have rather it seen Best Adventure game win, because the whole indie... it's kind of self-segregating almost.
Yeah, it kind of feels like when the Oscars introduce, like, the best animated film category instead of just, like, letting animated films just like, well, let them stand for what they are. Put them in any category instead. It kind of feels like that a little bit. Like, I feel like indie games should totally be able to stand on in all the other categories.
Was Journey nominated for Game of the Year? I think it was, wasn't it?
Or maybe not. I don't remember.
I'm not sure.
Walking Dead won,
which is interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, very interesting. Yeah. Kind of a nice surprise, I thought.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people like that game for how it plays, though.
No.
I feel a little weird.
Right. No, I kind of felt the same way, actually. I really, really enjoy the Walking Dead game, but... I enjoy it really for the story, you know, that's why I'm in it to play it, you know, to really figure out what's going to happen.
I really adored Dishonored. I thought that game was just a masterpiece.
Yeah, which won Best Action Adventure game, I think.
Yeah, it was great. What a hell of a setting in that game.
Absolutely.
Great environmental storytelling. Love it. So, do we have any more questions? We do.
I didn't want to cut you guys off. I've been biting my tongue a lot. I want to, before I forget, Psychic Frog?
Psychic Frog, yeah.
That's the best idea I've ever heard in my life.
Are you serious?
That is so good. Yes!
Yeah,
we all feel like a psychic frog sometimes.
Yeah.
Trapped in the systems that we were born into with with a strange skill set that we're not sure is applicable to... To me, it's like the story of being an art student. Psychic frog. Yeah. That's exactly how I felt. Brilliant.
Yeah, it's fun. You collect coffee mugs and ashtrays and stuff off of crates because it's heavily suggested that the henchmen in this organization don't do shit.
And
except just stand around and drink coffee and smoke. Chain smoke. And the frog doesn't like smoke. So if you can bean someone with an ashtray, he says no smoking.
I've been biting my tongue a lot.
The background music in Psychic Frog is actually a Tchaikovsky string quartet. It's a bizarre...
booming string quartet that makes the frog's adventure seem really epic. And
which it is.
Sort of guessing that's like... for me, it's like the alarm system for when the frog is loose. And they're all like, shit, you know, thing got out. But yeah, anyways, sorry.
So I'm going to do these questions because I feel guilty.
Okay.
Let's see. Grimslayer asks, what other types of styles would White Whale Games like to develop? RPG? Point and click?
Not point and click. I think we're sort of interested in procedural stuff right now and looking into sort of procedural action-y kind of stuff or horror.
Can you explain that in a little more of a layman's term for those, or is it...
Oh, yeah. We're really interested in emergent stuff and systems and emergent things in narrative and ways to create very personal kinds of stories that come out of the interoperability of the systems. But we haven't really settled on what is to be done next. We're still hard at work doing stuff for God of Blades and...
But it'll still be pretty narrative driven because that's one thing I think I touched on before. But
I would think that to me that kind of seems to be part of just like what... I think that's just kind of the idea at this point too. It's like that White Whale Games produces very narrative driven projects, which I personally really enjoy.
And that doesn't necessarily mean that it has a lot of text or anything, just that it has an interesting... creates interesting stories out of the gameplay.
Well, even Psychic Frog, I don't know if there's any text in that, but I already know
there's a little bit.
Henchmen are smoking, and
that's
it doesn't sound like you're looking at just creating a Pac-Man anytime soon.
Right. Well,
you're creating worlds and universes.
Yeah. That's what I really enjoy doing is.
The
setting.
When we came into starting White Whale, I think we pretty much like. I mean, we essentially went in saying we want to create like meaningful, realized worlds, and so like God of Blades is certainly an example of that. And I think Psychic Frog is too.
Really thought about it that way, but yeah, I guess it is. It
doesn't sound like you guys can help it. Like it's just where your minds kind of go.
No, definitely.
Yeah.
And the artist, I'm sorry, I'm blanking on his name.
Jason. He's hanging out in Virginia right now, so he's hanging out in the woods.
No, Vermont.
Vermont.
Yeah.
He's another V state. Yeah.
Yeah. He's on doing a cabin thing.
He sounds like a guy who can get so lost, and that's the kind of person you need on a project like that. Like, I don't know if you've played many fighting games. It seems like you had from playing God of Blades, but there's a lot of argument between what's harder, polygon-based graphics or just hand-drawn graphics. And what tell people for advice is, if you get a hand-drawn artist who can get lost in that world and is really good, that's actually going to be cheaper for you because with people with that level of skill, you can get hundreds of thousands of dollars out of just like a fraction of that if they're that good. And that's how he sounds. He sounds
he is a monster of artwork. He is a monster of artwork,
absolutely. I kind of there's actually just, you talking about that kind of sparked, maybe you remember too, on our blog recently, Jason actually wrote this big post about kind of developing this new stage for God of Blades featuring all these like giant jellyfish, which we call the Star Striders. And I think that's a great example of just kind of how his brain operates, because he pretty much is like designed how these jellyfish mate and has a whole protocol for like their world and how they act and operate. And so
And I know he believes that going into things on that level and internalizing it narratively helps artists make their work feel concrete, and you know, things will guide you if you let them, and they'll take on kinds of meaning and value too, and that may not ever come out to anyone else, but it helps the work. So
absolutely.
But yeah, he's a very thoughtful dude and real talented.
Yeah,
and he's our creative director as well. So
sounds like a huge asset. All right, I'm envious. You know him. Huskell Bolin asks, "What material outside of games inspire you creatively?" I guess that can be as general as you'd like it to be.
No, I think that's a great question because I think one of the things that I tell people is don't take your inspiration from other video games. Otherwise, I mean, you certainly can. And it's very clear that we do and did, but it's really important to think about other kinds of art and media too.
So yeah.
For me, reading, film, are probably the two biggest ones.
Yeah, I'd say.
Is there movies? I'm sorry.
We'll let George say words first.
Well, I don't know. I'm kind of too all over the place with movies, but I did a talk recently. We have an event called Nerd Night in Austin that's a lot of fun, where we get people come in and fill a venue and just give lectures on things that are interesting. And I gave one a couple months ago in October about my top 20 obscure horror movies from before 1980 that you simply must see. So I mean, like, I've gone pretty deep into that sort of rabbit hole. And
can you give me a few? I'm really curious.
Do we have a list on the website? We might not, actually. But we should post the list.
I can tell you what some of them were for sure. One is a Swedish silent film called Haxan, or Witchcraft Through the Ages. It's a brilliant film. Really interesting on a number of levels. One of the most expensive films made at there. It was made in, it was 1921, I believe. It was not widely successful because it was too controversial. But it's really quite an impressive film. Some of the other ones were from the 70s. Like, 70s were really strong for horror. Like, Death Dream is really good. It's sort of an anti-war horror thing where guy comes home from Vietnam, except that he's dead, and his mother just wanted him to come home so much that it happened that he has to start eating blood to live, and he's all withdrawn and weird. It's really good.
American film?
It is. Actually, it may have been Canadian, but Bob Clark directed it, and he directed Black Christmas, which is the first notable slasher film, although
I think he also made A Christmas Story.
He sure did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, so he made Death Dream, Black Christmas, and Christmas Story. Yeah. All of which are pretty awesome.
So, yeah, I like Bob Clark a lot.
Yeah,
I walked with the zombie.
With Dead Things, I think. Oh.
Yes, he did. Yeah. I Walked with a Zombie is another really good one. And so is Night of the Demon, or Curse of the Demon. It goes by two titles. But it's Jacques Tournier, or I don't know how to say his last name right, because I can't say French things right. But it's really good. So.
There's a whole list of that one.
But you know, you got to find your inspiration comes from all kinds of places.
I think that's also it's really cool with our team. You know, I think we all have lots of really diverse outside interests. Like, I'm like, film's kind of in my background too, and more specifically, a lot of my influence growing up was Jim Henson projects and just like all of Jim Henson's early stuff and all throughout his career. Like, he was just the way he worked, and then also just the way his brain, like, I have, you know, tons of published books that are like of his sketches and stuff. Like, he's highly influential for myself and how my creative brain operates. I think also, just, I think it's safe to say for all of us, like, stuff in the real world, like nature, and then also like literally today I was just showing George, I just bought this awesome coffee table book of abandoned USSR buildings and monuments, and which is amazing.
Sort of space age looking stuff, brutalist kind of Soviet concrete architecture, but yeah, pretty cool. So, you know, well, I mean, like, one of the things was an influence on part of Levels and God of Blades, and no one's picked up, or no one's told me that they've seen it, but you ever seen the movie Phase 4? The only film that Saul Bass ever directed? He did did a lot of title sequences for Hitchcock, and he did the original Ocean's 11 title sequence. It's really good work, but the only film he ever directed was this really weird design heavy abstracty sci-fi film called Phase 4 that's a psychedelic cosmic event happens, and then the ants in the world get their shit together and start sort of taking over, and so they build these weird monolithic mounds with a single aperture at the top, and they're like these weird, big, weird pillars, and the suggested there's more, I guess, but they just kind of stand there and watch, and I was like, oh, these things are great. So we put them in the backgrounds in one of the levels, the ant.
That's awesome.
It's a great film, sort of.
Phase 4, I'll look into that. Phase 4. Sounds 70s-ish.
Yeah, it was 70s, yeah.
71 or
something. Yeah, we actually saw a new print of it that the Academy brought to the Alma Draft House, to the theater here in town.
And they had this super crazy ending, that had been found, in his personal stuff that was donated to the Academy's film archive after he died, and they found this thing. It was Phase 4, Saul's ending, and they were like, what the shit? So they checked it out, and it's this great stuff where people have these weird goggles in there and these weird black balls, and they're living in hive cities because they've discovered a new way to live under their ant overlords, and it has they have numbers instead of names and cell block designations, and so it's super awesome.
It's amazing.
Wow.
So
that's incredible. Yeah, I've been wondering a lot. That speaks to, this is just a question amongst friends. This isn't related to your work at all, but it seems like you guys think about this a good amount, so maybe you'll have an answer. I don't know where sci-fi is going to go right now, because sci-fi historically plays upon both the things we're excited and the things we're afraid are going to happen. And I don't know what people are excited or afraid about anymore. The internet's kind of done. They already did that with the Matrix.
The ideas of surveillance are still an issue, and I don't know. One of the problems that sci-fi has had since Star Wars is that it often gets cashed as a blockbuster in the making kind of thing.
Yeah, that's
and everything has to be a big blockbuster with tons of special effects, and a lot of the more thoughtful sci-fi stuff is more low budget, or so. I hear Looper's good. I haven't seen it. I know Time Crimes is really good. Low budget. It's real cool. And Primer is really interesting. I'm stuck on time travel movies now. So
time travel's the thing.
I don't know.
Yeah, because we're in a time now where people kind of don't know what we represent. Every other era used to have a real solid look and feel, and I don't know what our we're just
right.
You know, this is funny because one of my best friends just asked me about a month ago on the phone. We were talking, and he said, "Do you think in the future people will make films that are set in 2012?" And I was like, "Well, yeah, I guess so, sure." And he's like, "Well, why? You know, when you look at the," I was like, "Well, I mean, I don't know. It's a time that things can be set in." But he's like, no, I mean, choose 2012 specifically because it's at that certain point in aesthetics or design or technology and that kind of stuff. And I was like, I don't know, because, you know, we did just kind of have the internet and this kind of stuff like that. So, but it's hard for fish to see the water that it's in. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you know, the 1930s have a really distinctive look. And so I don't know. But I actually talked about this with Jason, our creative director, and he suggested perhaps the defining thing right now is access and remix. People keep, you know, appropriating things and remixing them, and the rise of sort of memes and this kind of user-generated culture and that kind of stuff at a level at which people can really easily do it now. Maybe that's it, but I don't know. I don't know either where sci-fi movies are going or if movies will be set in 2012.
Yeah. But something except to think about, eh?
For the movie.
Yeah, 20, I mean, I'd be really curious, too. I think, if anything...
Which was set, I think, in 2011.
Was it?
No.
Sorry. I can be kind of gullible sometimes. Yeah, no, I think also with the... In terms of just talking about movies, too, like, I think... I'm really curious to see kind of what happens with sci-fi projects, too, just because, like, I feel like in the past few years, people have gotten really worn down with franchises, like... movie, just like, you know, everything like this past summer. And I mean, there are great films, but like 90% of it is like sequels or, you know, remakes or all that. So
it's hard to get new stuff made.
Yeah, it is. In the way the studio operates.
Risk diverse right now.
But the cynicism towards The Hobbit and Star Wars 7, I'm sure they'll do okay. But just when you ask people, they're like, they don't care about me. They care about my money at this point.
Yeah.
Right.
Totally.
But the new Muppets movie sounds pretty good.
Well, see, it was great. Well, that actually, yeah, that
it was a great movie.
That like Jason Segel is at the end of the day a hardcore Muppet purist, which is real. I'm gonna roll with that phrase, but he's a Muppet purist, and yeah, I think they did a great job of throwing that out. So that was a shining example, I guess, in like new from old franchises.
I wanted to ask you, Joe, what it is about Jim Henson that you love.
Oh, man.
It's hard to sum up, I'm sure, but it's worth talking about, I think.
I think a lot of, at the end of the day, I'm kind of one of these people, I really am an explorer, and I really love the outdoors, and I really love all these, and I really love tales that are just very pure, and I feel like for example, like I'll just throw out like Fraggle Rock, I think is kind of, like really kind of articulates really well why I like Jim Henson, because it's like, I mean, that's a tale of like a peaceful, loving community and like, you know, working with different, like working with other parts of the environment, working with smaller people and working with large people, working with the doozers and then, you know, dealing with all these different parts of society and just like still shooting though for like peaceable working, you know? And so it's really kind of hard to articulate, but like, I don't know, there's just something very special in so much of like, in all his projects, it just really, really spoke to me growing up, and just really resonated with me.
We should talk about the soundtrack too, real quick.
The God of Blades.
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Let's do it. We have 5 minutes left, so that's definitely something.
I think it's I really, really like the soundtrack, and that's the first score that the guy that did it's ever done. He was another student with Joe and I. That's how we knew him. In the master's program, I asked him if he could make me a something like a sonic landscape that's like Thor was up all night, like drinking and battling, and then he vomited all over a wall of Moog synthesizers, and you know it's the early 70s. I need this to be like a dreamy landscape thing too, and I think he did a really good job. He channeled a lot of sort of John Carpenter kind of stuff, or like Goblin.
Oh, sure, so, from Dawn of the Dead soundtrack and a bunch of horror movies.
Kind of,
and those guys are creepy.
It's great stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So. I was sad. It's not a game. You can appreciate the game with the music off, I think, but turning it on adds a huge level of emotional depth, I think.
And music was an important inspiration too for the game.
Yeah, absolutely.
Really important.
I want to talk more about Jim Henson.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite Henson project?
Mine's Labyrinth.
I love Labyrinth a lot. I love Dark Crystal a little more.
I love Dark Crystal. Dark Crystal, I think, is a good example of like extreme world building, and maybe it didn't get executed perfectly in terms of like appealing to a mainstream audience. But you know, when you watch that and you watch like the documentary, like, there is so much thought put into every little thing in that world. And
I love the Skeksis.
Yeah, the Skeksis are amazing.
They're so good, and that voice acting. The thing about Jim Henson is it's not just, I mean, the designs he was willing to put out there. There's no precedent for Muppets being popular, but he did it anyway because that's where his heart was. And he did the voices, and he did the storyline.
Well, also puppetry itself is like totally part of like what makes it so amazing. Like, you know, just like the movement of the puppets, like you are totally believing this universe because like you have really effective performers. So
That too.
And I think that's what makes something good. And I think that's what makes a good game in a lot of ways. A good game is that your heart does that. Mm-hmm. There's no real substitute for that. And you can tell when somebody's phoning something in or when somebody's really, you're reaching out.
And admittedly, in a corny way, maybe that's a better way to articulate like why I like Jim Henson, is because at the end of the day, like those projects like really scream out heart, you know? Like it's like, you know, that there is a lot of, I mean, I have no better way to articulate it, but yeah, you can tell it is a passion project. There's something really that the whole team is really into, and not just trying to make a bunch of bucks.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Fraggle Rock, I think, is kind of a whole look at class culture.
Absolutely.
I've got to bite my tongue though, because we have 2 minutes left. Speaking of heart, you guys, people may not know from looking at God of Blades, when things are really clean and beautiful, sadly, in the indie community, people have thought, oh, well, you know, that's a high-budget project that isn't really made from the heart, like the kind of chunky-looking pixelated games. But you guys put so much art into your goddamn game, and I want people to know that and to give it a shot and to play it. For
thank
99
so
cents. For Jesus Christ, 99 cents. You're not asking a lot. How long is that sale going on for? Is it?
It's going on until the end of the month, it's looking like. Yeah. So we decided to extend it because people seem to respond pretty well to it. And right now, we'd really love to just invite more people to check out what we've built.
So. Yeah, and go find some insane psychedelic book covers, too.
That would be awesome,
and,
too.
And email, and tweeter them. Tweet them upon me.
Tweet them towards our way.
I love it.
We love seeing that stuff. And we also love
happy when we get that stuff.
Yeah.
Love it.
We talk to everybody, so if anybody wants to throw questions or talk to us or send us cool art.
Yeah, if anybody had questions they didn't get to ask, they can totally email us.
Awesome. What is your email and Twitters and all
those? My Twitter is just Joe Lammert. George is George Royer.
Yeah,
we're very creative.
And you know, follow us on at White Will Games too.
Yeah, if you email us at White Will Games, that goes my way, and I typically relay it to everybody. So if you just go to whitewillgames.com, it's like info at White Will Games, I think. So
yeah, so just send the questions to the info email off our website.
Or tweet
or whatever.
And they can get the game on iTunes, and they can play
right now
Slayers.
It's in the App Store.
Oh, right. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Slayers is free for Mac and PC. It's really fun. And we'll be coming out on Android soon-ish. We haven't figured out exactly when yet. But
then upcoming PC
the road,
in 2013.
Yeah.
And Psychic Frog.
And Psychic Frog on WhiteWheelGames.com.
Is free. It may be under the Orca section.
Yeah, it's under the Orca section.
It's under the Orca section, but yeah.
Which we hope to grow in the next year.
Yeah, so.
Cool. That's awesome, guys. You did it.
Yeah,
we made it. I can't believe an hour and a half just like already went by.
Yeah, this is great.
I know.
Thank you so much.
And pleasure.
Thanks everybody who's watching or listening. Really flattered and honored to be asked to speak. It's great.
Thank you so much.
I'm glad I discovered you guys, or you discovered me, or someone discovered somebody.
Somebody discovered somebody. It was great. It's a treasure.
If we discovered you, does that mean we can name you?
I'd love to be renamed, because I have the same name as a pornographic film star, and it gets me in a lot of trouble.
With the cops?
Just in social situations. Usually with older men who just want to talk about it for a long time.
Oh, God.
I know.
Yeah.
Some of those guys are going to be cops.
On that note.
So long, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thanks so much.
Bye. Thank you so much. That was fun.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Thanks so much, guys.
Thanks so much.
Oh, it's great.
We just like chatting about things.